On the day, I was working upstairs in the house and one of my sons just came up and said something terrible's happening at Hillsborough. And this was only the second semi-final that I'd actually missed. I'd been to all Liverpool semi-finals until the previous year at Hillsborough and then 1989. And I think my memory, my abiding memory, is watching snooker world championships on grandstand from Sheffield being interrupted by an emerging tragedy. And at first, you had the impression that a few people had been injured in a crush. But then very soon, as bodies were being carted across the pitch on advertising hoardings, you realised that you were watching something that had never happened before in the way this was unfolding. And as a football supporter, I kind of immediately felt an affinity with what was happening and a horror. And I think also I knew the potential, I knew what could happen in those circumstances because I'd stood on the terraces myself. And of course, it was 4 years after Heysel and 4 years after Bradford. And it was a feeling of, oh no, here we go again. This is incredible, it can't possibly be happening. And then the later memory was observing a senior director of Liverpool coming out of the ground late in the evening on national news. And when he was asked what he thought about the disaster, he said, I hate to think what this is going to do for our chances of getting back into Europe. And I thought that typified a problem that somehow football was more significant than tragedy. And I think that was one of the driving forces behind my own direct involvement in my professional work. I'd done considerable amounts of work for years on controversial deaths, deaths in custody. And so, in one sense, it was obvious that I would become involved with researching and funding for researching into the aftermath of Hillsborough. But at the same time, it carried a kind of emotional feel that went against, I suppose, the objectivity of my research at that time, and I had to come to terms with that. I had to come to terms with the fact that I had an emotional tie, not only to the city, my city, not only to football and soccer, but also to the families and the struggles that they were facing. And I had to square that with the academic work that I was then going to be doing. And at the time, I thought we would be doing that academic work for 2 to 3 years. And in fact, it has gone on for 11 years. I think the key issue around Hillsborough is the argument and debate that there has been about the late arrival of fans at the ground. It was April the 15th. It was a hot summer's day. It was the end of a cool early spring, so there was still snow on the hills over the Pennines. And people started to arrive from quite an early time in the city. Some of those people would not be going to the game. They would come as families and some would go shopping while the others went to the match. Those who went off to the game, stopped, maybe had a drink at a pub, went and got something to eat, and found their way up to the ground. But one thing that was very clear was that first of all, there were roadworks on the motorway, and quite a lot of the trains were also delayed. So there was train delays, coach delays, and a lot of the coaches were being searched en route, so they were being pulled in at motorway services. So there was a very gradual build-up at the ground during the 3 hours before the game. By about 2 o'clock, the two central pens immediately behind the goal were already fairly full, and the two main side pens were almost entirely empty. That was because a lot of people who'd arrived early wanted to get their spec right behind the goals. But because there were delays in the rest of the crowd arriving, and quite a lot of them had to walk some considerable distance to the ground from the parks or from car parks or from the station, it wasn't until about 2:30 that there became a real concentration outside the ground. What we know now, in hindsight, was that the small area that feeds the two sets of turnstiles, that small area had to cope with over 26,000 people going through it. because unlike any other ground, the access for the stand that runs along the north side of the ground was in the same area as the access for both the seating, the stand at the Leppings Lane end, but also for the Leppings Lane terrace. So almost half of the entire crowd that went into that stadium had to go through that confined area. And it had been long warned, although we didn't know it at the time, it had been long warned within the South Yorkshire Police that that was a problem, a real problem, a bottleneck. And that's exactly what happened at about 2:30 as people started to arrive. It wasn't a case of ticketless fans conspiring to get in, drunken people fighting to get in. All of those were the myths of, have been the myths of Hillsborough. It was purely and simply arrival of fans coming off coaches, coming from the trains, coming from the car parks in an orderly fashion. And too many people were arriving for the pace of the antiquated turnstiles to take them through. The people at the front couldn't tell the people at the back how crowded it was. So what then happened was that the police outside, now desperate because the crowd had built up, now desperate for some relief of the crush, which looked as though it was going to end in tragedy itself, asked the head police officer, the chief of the ground commander for the day, the match commander for the day, David Duckenfield, asked him if they could open the exit gates to let fans in. And that's exactly what happened. Eventually, after hesitating, the match commander agreed, the exit gate C was opened, and the fans entered through exit gate C, unstewarded, unpoliced. They didn't break step, they walked. And they walked directly opposite that gate to an archway that said standing. They could see through to the ground. And they went down a 1-in-6 gradient tunnel onto the back of 2 already full pens. Because of lateral fencing and because of perimeter fencing, the crowd that was already in had nowhere to go. So literally, those 2 central pens, one of which had a license for 1,000 people, the other had a license for 1,100 people, had twice as many people in them. It was like a vice, and it got tighter and tighter, until at the front of one of the pens, pen 3, a barrier broke, and people went down on under the pressure from behind into a mass of tangled bodies. In both pens, people died, but in pen 3, that was where most deaths occurred. The result of that was 96 people died, 400 people were hospitalised, 700 people were injured, and thousands of people were traumatised. Many of their lives have been cut short, and many of their working lives have ended prematurely. It was the worst football disaster, worst disaster at a football stadium in British football history. And I think that the issue is that it was always on the cards. It was entirely predictable. It was entirely foreseeable. The way in which grounds had come to be left more or less to go to rack and ruin, the way in which grounds were not safety oriented, the way in which the police were not safety oriented remains one of the great scandals of Hillsborough to this day. And one example suffices. There is no mention of safety in the entire operational order for the South Yorkshire Police for that day. It was all about crowd control and nothing about crowd safety. While the bodies were still being pulled from the pens, Graham Kelly and Glenn Curtin from the FA went up to the police control box and spoke to David Duckenfield, the match commander from the South Yorkshire Police, and asked him what had happened. He said that the Liverpool fans had basically broken into the stadium, that they had rushed into the back of the fans already in the central pens and caused the deaths. Minutes later, completely unwittingly, Graham Kelly then speaks to the world's media and relays that story. That was, without any question, as 2 judges have since said, a disgraceful lie that had come from David Duckenfield. But what it did was it set an agenda. It set an agenda that by the evening, when the decision was taken to turn the Sheffield Wednesday Gymnasium into a temporary mortuary and to place the bodies of those who died in body bags and clean them up with a flannel and a sponge, their faces with a flannel and a sponge, before they would be presented to their loved ones. The coroner had already taken a decision that the blood alcohol levels of every single fan who died, including a child as young as 10, would be taken. The only conceivable reason that blood alcohol levels were taken was because he considered that drunkenness might have contributed to the deaths of those men, women and children. That arose directly out of a connection to the lie that had been earlier promulgated that Liverpool fans had stormed into the stadium. That then set another agenda, which was how the loved ones of those people who died were treated when they arrived in Sheffield. When people arrived in Sheffield, they went from the hospitals to the holding area, which was a disused, stinking boys' club that hadn't been open for over a year, which was supposed to be holding the people arriving in Sheffield until they were called to the stadium, and then they went to the stadium. They were bused to the stadium in double-decker buses. They came off those buses. They queued up in the cold night. We're talking now about late night and early morning. They waited to go into the stadium. Inside the gymnasium, they were confronted with screens which had the photographs taken with a Polaroid camera of those who died, faces in body bags. They tried to make the identification. They would then give the number of the person they thought was their loved one. That number was called out. The body was then delivered to the door of the gymnasium on a trolley. They then made a positive identification, and if the identification was positive, they were taken to tables where they were then interrogated by the South Yorkshire CID. This was supposed to be a statement of identification, but they were asked questions about whether their loved one had a criminal record, whether they were drunk regularly, whether they would have taken a drink on the way, whether they'd drunk the night before. Clearly then, we can see a direct connection from the moment that the match commander told that lie right the way through until the loved ones of those who died were actually interrogated. And then, by the middle of the week, we have The Sun publishing the famous The Truth story, in which it was alleged that the fans were drunken, violent, had urinated on police officers, and stolen from and sexually abused some of those who died. These were the same fans who'd torn down advertising hoardings to carry people across the pitch in order to try and get them to safety. The other issue that is absolutely clear is not only did the police not react in time because they thought it was crowd violence rather than a crowd safety issue, not only did the police react, but the medical facilities at the ground were woefully inadequate for a crowd of that size. There were only, I think, 3 stretchers, for example. The doctors and nurses came from out of the crowd, but a lot of people were left for dead on the pitch. And one of the things that still is so deeply hurtful to many of the families is the real belief, and they're probably right, that many of those who died could have been saved had the medical intervention been appropriate and early enough. So we can contrast the way in which people struggled for life, the way in which people tried to save life, with the way in which they then were vilified, particularly in the press and some sections of the press. And that continued. That continued all through the Taylor inquiry. It continued after Taylor had said the main cause of the disaster was overcrowding and the main reason for the disaster was police mismanagement of the crowd. It continued through the inquests, through into the judicial review of the inquests, then through to the 1998 scrutiny of new evidence, and right up to and including the trial of former Chief Superintendent Duckenfield and Superintendent Bernard Murray in July 2000. That whole process of vilifying the fans, portraying them as hooligans, stating that they were drunk and ticketless, that has been the cloud that's hung over Hillsborough. And what the research, what every bit of objective evidence demonstrates, is that that is so far from the truth. The obvious was actually the reality. that people went innocently to a football match, they expected their welfare would be looked after, and it cost them their lives. And it was a multiplicity of factors. Poor and complacent policing, an inadequate and structurally unsafe ground, procedures around safety that had been haphazard and not followed through, a safety certificate that was 10 years out of date, and an FA that hadn't actually really taken the time or effort to put crowd safety in hiring the venue ahead of crowd control. Immediately after Hillsborough, three investigations began. There was the Taylor inquiry, which was a Home Office inquiry. There was the criminal investigation, which was conducted by the West Midlands Police on behalf of the South Yorkshire Police. And there was the coroner's inquest. And they ran not exactly in parallel, but in close proximity. Because you had the Taylor inquiry being absolutely clear about the cause and reason for the disaster being about police mismanagement and overcrowding, and yet you had accidental death verdicts in the coroner's inquest, the two didn't sit well alongside each other. The criminal prosecution outcome was that the Director of Prosecutions decided there was insufficient, not no evidence, but insufficient evidence to prosecute any individual. The inquests were judicially reviewed because of the apparent contradiction of an accidental death verdict, but it was stated that even though there had been in the civil courts negligence attributed to the South Yorkshire Police in a parallel action, that you could accommodate negligence within an accidental death verdict. And so it rumbled on. But the key issue here was that the families never had access, never had disclosure of any of the information relating to their loved ones. It took until 1998 for them to first see the body files, that is the full file on each of their loved ones, the full statements around the death of each person. It took all of that time to gain that access. And that came primarily because Driakstraw decided on a judicial scrutiny to see if there was new evidence relating to what had actually happened on the day. So as late as 1998, we now have a scrutiny which was not an inquiry, but had a similar kind of remit. That stated quite clearly that there was no new evidence of any note, that therefore it wouldn't have changed the previous decisions. And the families then decided to take a private prosecution, or had already decided to take a private prosecution against the two most senior officers. The outcome of that in July 2000 was that one of those senior officers was acquitted and the jury was hung over the culpability of the other. And that is basically the end of the Hillsborough litigation. But it's gone on for 11 years. And still, at the end of those 11 years, in terms of culpability and acknowledgement, the families and the survivors are no nearer establishing precisely, openly, the full responsibility for the day. Following the scrutiny by Lord Justice Stuart Smith in 1998, Jack Straw took the decision to place all of the police statements and all of the inquiry records into the House of Commons Library, and after a bit of a battle, I got access to them. I, at the same time, had very close contact with a former police officer in the South Yorkshire Police, and his story that statements had been reviewed and altered was actually clearly evidenced by the statements that I looked through, the 700 times three, because there were three versions of them, statements that I looked through in the House of Lords reading room. And what this revealed was that the South Yorkshire Police, in collaboration with the four solicitors, in the immediate aftermath of Hillsborough, had gone through a process of review and alteration of all police statements that had been taken as recollections of those police officers. That was the evidence that then was put to the West Midlands Police Investigation Team and the inquest and Lord Justice Taylor. In other words, the recollections, handwritten by each police officer, went through a process of review and alteration by their managers in collaboration with the fourth solicitor, and what came out of that was a modified statement from each police officer. Some of the statements weren't changed, they didn't need to be. But most of the changes hinged on the responsibilities of senior officers of the South Yorkshire Police. And in one dramatic case, almost half of the statement had been entirely changed, and the police officer actually refused to sign it. There's no question that football grounds in the Premiership, most of them, are such a far cry from football grounds in the First Division at the time of Hillsborough that they're beyond recognition. We have some of the best football stadiums now in the world, proportionate to the fans that we have going to them. They're much safer, they're much cleaner, the facilities are much better, and importantly, they're all-seater, although there is a tendency now behind the goals for people to stand throughout the match. The stewarding is more effective, and I would hope that the policing is more effective also. The perimeter fencing has gone, and all of the penning and segregation in that way has gone. There are much safer places to be, they're much nicer places to be. But that is only as far as the Premiership is concerned. There's a whole range of other venues in football and in other leisure activities which are intrinsically unsafe, and where you could still have, with a set of circumstances coming together, a tragedy. Maybe not on the same scale as Hillsborough, but certainly another tragedy. I'm also sceptical about the way in which the debate is now going over the return of football terraces. To bring back terraces would not be to bring back terraces as they were, and there will be an argument put forward that you can now make terraces safe. And I think there's a real concern about that. I'm cynical about why that argument is being put forward, and I think it's about finance. I think it's about getting more people into the ground more cheaply, bringing people back to football, extending the market. But football is now a multi-billion pound business. It is so different. Premiership football, with all of the TV rights and everything else, is so different to anything we could have envisaged in the late 1980s. And a lot of that has come as a result of Hillsborough. But I also think there is an ease with which we can become complacent. In the late 40s, there was a football match at Bolton Wanderers Ground, Burnden Park. 33 people died in an incident that was almost to the minute a duplicate of what happened at Hillsborough. The Mulwyn-Hughes report came as a result of that. And had the Mulwyn-Hughes report been enacted in full, at Hillsborough, there would not have been that disaster at Hillsborough. In other words, nearly 30 years before, we had a report which actually clearly stated the kinds of measures that should be taken to protect the safety of people in football grounds. And over time, it was eroded. Over time, it was dismissed. Over time, new systems for dealing with so-called hooligans, corralling, spotting, penning, they're all police words, those were used, and they cut across the recommendations of the Mulwyn-Hughes report. What I'm always concerned about is how over time we do forget, how we forget the lessons that have been learned from previous disasters. And when you read the disaster at Burnden Park from the late 40s, and you see the way in which that unfolded, you would think you were talking about Hillsborough. So yes, there is no question that football grounds are much safer places to be. We have a much greater degree of safety awareness and safety consciousness. But I don't think we can ever become complacent, and we must always try and remember Hillsborough as if it happened yesterday and not a decade ago. I think I've always had a real concern about the relationship between Hillsborough and football, because I used to be a season ticket holder at Liverpool myself. I used to love going to the match. I think that the moment that stands out for me more than anything else is the way in which Arsenal winning the league in 1989 from Liverpool in the last minute at Anfield has become almost a beacon of great celebration for football. this was Arsenal against the odds winning a championship, and Nick Hornby has immortalised it in Fever Pitch. The players on the pitch that night, who were playing for Liverpool, many of them only that week had been at funerals. Many of them only that week had been at the bedsides of people who were trying to recover from the worst experience of their life. And yet somehow, even in that short period of time, by mid-May, even in that short period of time, what had happened only a month before seemed to be irrelevant because a championship was at stake. And I think if you tie that in to many of the kinds of comments that we've heard from senior directors in football clubs, like, don't you think it's about time that the bereaved got over it? Don't you think that they have now had enough time to put it behind them? It makes me feel that there is a certain kind of cynicism born out of business optimism about how you almost denigrate the memories of those people who died because football is so important and so significant. And of course football isn't that important and isn't that significant. But we've rebuilt a game in Britain, and we've rebuilt an interest. We've brought new people to football, and it is seen to be more important than death. And that is not an acceptable equation. And I think that is the moment that really brought it home to me in retrospect, was seeing the way in which the championship that year continued and it was won in such dramatic style. And yet at the same time, people who were still or had just been buried. I mean, the great thing about being a football supporter and being brought up as a football supporter is the excitement, the fun, the enjoyment, the camaraderie, what you do before the game, what you do during the game, talking about it afterwards. Nobody expects to go to a football match and die. They're not my words, they're the words of the mother of Lee Nicol, Pat Nicol. Lee was a child and died at Hillsborough. And I think that that sums up the complacency around crowd safety for me. You go in expecting to be looked after, stewarded, shown to you part of the ground. The police had a phrase about fans at Hillsborough: they find their own level. You couldn't be more complacent than that. The idea was that fans would go in and just find their own level. They'd elbow their way in to get to their own spec or wherever it was convenient for them. But it was left to them. And it's that complacency, along with the complacency around the condition of the ground, the condition of the terrace, the way the police failed to respond, the way in which football supporters were never seen as fans in the way we saw ourselves, but were seen as animals. I say animals because we're talking about pens. They're called pens. They're cages. The process in police parlance was penning. The process of bringing fans to the ground in police parlance was corralling. Once you have that kind of language being used to describe people, men, women and children, having their day out, you're putting that experience onto a totally different level. Their civil liberties have gone. They can't go where they like. They're corralled. They're walked to the ground. They're delivered. I think Lord Justice Taylor said it was like a military operation. And then they were put in pens. And those pens are cages. They were caged in. That's what you do to animals. And so many times we see the word animal used to describe hooligans. And once we allow ourselves to then use that as a stereotype, we then become complacent about safety and about caring for people who are actually spending good money to have their day out at football match and to have their excitement. But we come to accept that. And we also, that's at the same time, assume that to even take a drink is somehow a risk, is somehow unacceptable. We would never say that about Glyndebourne. We would never say that about Wimbledon. We would never say that about Lords. But we said it about football supporters. What was wrong with having a couple of pints on the way to the game? Nothing. But that itself became part of a systematic vilification. And it's the issue that because we didn't see fans as people, we didn't see their needs, we didn't identify them, we didn't therefore police them, and we didn't steward them. And that all contributed to the deaths and the suffering of so many people. It also contributed to the media response afterwards and the whole way in which the legal cases were shaped. It's had a massive effect on the outcome, and I'm convinced that if it had been in almost any other leisure activity, we would have not had the cover-up, we would have not had the lack of disclosure of information, and we would have not had the long drawn-out process that we've had over Hillsborough. I think that the national press reported Hillsborough quite differently to the local press, but it all was tied in to the vilification of Liverpool in general. I mean, we cannot underestimate the way in which Liverpool itself as a city, Merseyside as a region, had been throughout the 1980s under the cosh of the national press and also national government. Liverpool was held up, if you like, as the whipping person for the Tory government. And remember the Hatton years and all that went with that. And there is no question that Liverpool became synonymous with football hooliganism and militancy and violence and a history of being pugnacious and those issues. It's not borne out by the reality or by the facts, but this was the myth that was created around Liverpool and to a large extent, in terms of football, had been fed 4 years earlier by Heysel. Now, the important issue here is we see shaping up an image of Liverpool and an image of football supporters who happen to be Liverpool supporters being brought together into that same dynamic. And it's actually 4 years later, in 1993, when James Bulger is killed in Liverpool, that we see the headlines, Heysel, Hillsborough, and now this. As if you can explain those quite, entirely different incidents around being from Liverpool or being of Liverpool. And that was the period when people went and laid down wreaths for James Bulger. And that was the period when they ran the headlines, Self-Pity City. That was the period when Liverpool became synonymous with being maudlin, with not being able to come to terms with reality. With, I think one of the points that was made, putting emotion above intellect. And that undoubtedly came from the national press and from feature writers in the national press. The vilification of Liverpool and Merseyside became so much a part of that whole process, and it was 10 years from basically the mid-1980s till the mid-1990s, and Hillsborough was caught right in the middle of it. I've never felt that Liverpool Football Club have done enough. It's my own personal opinion, but I don't think they've done enough for the families. I don't think they've done enough for survivors. They're a multi-million pound corporation. They're a PLC. Yes, there is a memorial at the ground. And yes, the ground was used for a fundraising concert. But I feel quite cynical about the way in which Liverpool Football Club, for example, hires out its facilities for meetings of the family support group. I can't believe that an institution of that size does not give automatically support to families. But I also understand the business imperative. I also understand that to actually have a disaster like Hillsborough hanging over the club is something that does not necessarily make for good business. And I think that it's not just about Liverpool Football Club doing more for the families. It's actually about a relationship between the club and its fans. On another point, I think that the response of Kenny Dalglish and the players at Liverpool in the immediate aftermath of Hillsborough was fantastic. It was brilliant. The support, the personal support. Some of those players went to 3 and 4 funerals. They went and visited people in hospital. They used their, if you like, hero status to actually bring some kind of support back to those families. And since then, all of the Liverpool management and players have continued every year to support the memorial. So on a personal level, the football players and the football management of Liverpool came very close to the fans, came very close to the bereaved and to the survivors. But in terms of the actual club itself as an institution, in terms of its directing, I think that if we look back, Liverpool was more concerned about getting back into Europe than any other single imperative. And that was its goal as a PLC, and I think that's continued.